earth from outer space. Everyone must find the place. Give me time, give me space. On our voyage of discovery into the mysteries of harmony, we've met the 24 basic triads and mischievous ways of slipping dissonances into them through passing notes and suspensions. But composers didn't stop there. They kept on trying to invent new chords. They turned them upside down, stretched them, squeezed them, and created all sorts of exotic new hybrids. In the next part, we're going to look at these chord mutations and how they change the course of modern music.
As composers became more adventurous with their harmonies, they began to do to chords what rose growers did to roses. They would take a note from one chord and graft it onto the root or stalk of another, producing exotic and colourful hybrids. They began propagating chords. To start off with, this really only meant one or two possible notes, like this one. The note we've added is a B flat, and when you add it to the chord of C major, you create a whole new type of chord. The note we've added is called a seventh because it lies seven steps up the musical scale from the bottom of the chord. What's so useful about adding a seventh to a chord is it gives that chord a new property, which turns it from a confident primary chord sort of a guy into something that's more vulnerable and needy. And that's because, musically speaking, it is more needy. You see, if you add a B flat to the chord of C, you destabilize that chord of C, and it now desperately wants to move to the strong chord of F major, like this. The ability to turn a chord from one mood to another, or to make it want to lean towards some other chord, was considered, rightly so, to be of immense musical value, because it was another device that you could use to make your harmony have more forward movement and energy. You should be able to hear what a difference these added notes make if I do a simple series of chords without any additions or modifications at all. Now I'm going to add a seventh to every other triad. Rock and roll practically lives on seventh chords. Listen how often this seventh chord, C sharp, crops up in the Phil Medley Burt Russell standard, Twist and Shout. Seventh chords were small fry compared to the kinds of exotic hybrids romantic composers and more recently jazz musicians liked. For Mozart, or early rock and rollers for that matter, ambiguity or uncertainty in your chords were bad things. You should be able to tell where the harmony's heading. For jazz giants like Miles Davis, though, the ambiguity offered by these hybrid chords was a good thing. It meant the harmony could head off in any direction it liked. Wagner would have approved. Creating unpredictability in your chords can be achieved by cultivating hybrids, piling one chord on top of another. But an even more drastic method is to tamper with the structure of the triads themselves. Think cosmetic surgery. Think enlargement and reduction. Or, in musical jargon, augmentation and diminution. So, we could take a basic triad of E flat, which are these three notes, And to augment this triad, we need to add a slightly higher note to the top. Here it is. This slightly higher note now replaces the B-flat, and our new augmented E-flat sounds like this. So much for augmentation. If you want to diminish a chord, you've got to do the opposite. You've got to make it a bit smaller. So, a C major triad normally sounds like this. But I'm going to reduce the size of this triad by taking away the bottom note. And our new chord starts here. The diminished chord sounds like this. Every time you diminish or augment a chord, you change its behavior. After all, if I had a part of my body enlarged, I'd probably start behaving differently. Diminished and augmented chords are volatile, ambiguous, and unpredictable.
All qualities that suited the fast, freewheeling style of jazz musicians like John Coltrane. In their hands, chords stopped simply progressing one after another. Instead, they were overlapping and cascading into each other in a constant stream. All of the above techniques, major and minor triads, suspensions, passing notes, augmentations, diminutions, and other chord combinations, were gradually absorbed into Western music over a period of roughly 300 years. And over the last century, they've begun to intermingle promiscuously, so that you might expect to hear a chord progression familiar to Bach suddenly crop up in a contemporary pop song.
Windmill, windmill for the land, the forever hand in hand. Take it all out on your stride, it is taking falling down. Love forever, love is free, let's turn forever.
Since its emergence over seven centuries ago, Western harmony hasn't stood still. It's fused with other musical systems. Bollywood is a case in point.
It's a remarkable fact that, being the only musical culture to have developed harmony through chords, Western music has now also exported it to other cultures. Indian music, for example, which has its own impressive and colourful 2,000-year-old musical tradition, has adopted Western harmony with considerable flair and enthusiasm. Bollywood music these days is a combination of Indian melody and rhythm and Western harmony. Harmony makes music sound warmer and fuller, but it has also undoubtedly enriched the emotional possibilities of music. Hearing voices sing together, brought closer by the added dimension of chords and their progressions, is one of the most beautiful things humankind has created in the last 500 years. Whether it's been to glorify God or express some deeply felt personal yearning, chordal harmony is one of our most spectacularly successful musical gifts.
You give me something that makes me scared, all right. This could be nothing, but I'm willing to give it a try. Flower.